Do you have any tips on how I can push my limits in a sustainable way? I'm in the middle of sweet spot based low volume 2 and have surprised myself by being able to train at 110 to 114% of my FTP this week with my power still staying on target. And the way she's doing that is with the Trainer Road app, you can just use the arrow keys, or on the mobile app, you can just change the intensity. So basically, she's riding at 110 or 114%. She just makes that adjustment and then it adjusts it for her. What's most surprising is how okay I've been feeling after these sessions. I've heard that it's not uncommon for female cyclists to be a little more conservative. I think I try to conserve my strength just in case I bonk, which we covered bonking in depth on the last episode, or I should say two episodes previous to this, so you can get more information there. She says, which rarely actually happens. And I think that what she really means in this case is not bonk, but blows up, so to speak. Mm-hmm. She says, but what ends up happening is that I underestimate my strength. Have I been underestimating my ability to dig deep, or have I gotten that much stronger since my last ramp test? I'd love to hear your thoughts on this. So first things first, before we jump into anything, it is totally possible that you've gotten that much stronger since your last ramp mm-hmm. test, especially in sweet spot base. When you're looking at going through that first part of it, you know, you can see a lot of improvement really quickly, and you can just take a ramp test to verify that. But Amber, looking at it from the other side of things of how to push yourself in a sustainable way, what thoughts do you have on that?
Yeah, well, when we talk about pushing too far, I think there's a couple of different things here that we want to make sure we're really clear on. So bonking is when you're not fueling enough, or your effort is outweighing your ability to refuel or to fuel the effort, right? So you're actually depleting glycogen, you're running that down. That's a nutritional kind of energy balance problem. And then, so that's bonking. Then we've had a lot of conversations around pushing too hard in terms of overreaching and overtraining. And that's more of a longer term. That's a time scale differentiation, right? So overreaching and overtraining occurs over weeks and months of time. So that's not something that you're necessarily, if you push too hard during a workout, if you're under fueling, yes, you could bonk. But if you're fueling appropriately and you're not running down those glycogen stores, given your effort level, you're not going to overreach or overtrain yourself in the context of a single workout. So that's something, you know, so I want to just be really clear. Those two things are something different. And then when you're just talking about pushing yourself in a workout, it really depends on what workout you're doing too, right? If it's an active recovery workout, or if you're meant to be doing a recovery week, those rides should feel rejuvenating. You should feel better at the end of those rides than you do beforehand. Shouldn't be depleting anything, shouldn't be fatiguing. But if you're doing something like Sweet Spot or VO2 Max, or you're doing like a long endurance effort, that's where this gets challenging. And the higher the level of the energy system, so as you move from sweet spot to threshold to VO2 to anaerobic, those sensations are going to get more and more uncomfortable and more difficult. So I would say, just, you know, in terms of time scale, there's nothing wrong with pushing yourself to the point of kind of blowing up in a workout, because you spin easy for 2-3 minutes, try again, you know. Or if you just blow yourself up in a workout and you say, okay, that's it, I'm calling it a day, you can come back and train again the next day. It's not going to be something that's going to be a nail in the coffin, like overreaching, overtraining, or bonking, where you might need a couple of days to recover from that.
Mm. That's a super important distinction, because I think that there are a handful of, it might just be because we're assimilating failure with and all the mental aspects of that happen mm-hmm. when we fail a workout. But physically speaking, our bodies are very capable of going to failure points, so to speak,
yeah,
and then rebounding from that. Like we just talked about, like Chad said, you know, about the replenishment and everything else that goes into it. And there are many workouts that effectively do that, especially VO2 workouts. Like, mm-hmm. you know, if somebody asks you, can you go 5 more seconds at the end of those VO2 intervals? Many times you're like, absolutely not. Like, that was everything I could do, but you somehow can do it again. So right. it's part of it, even may even be intentional with a workout to get you to that point where you're going that far, where it feels like this is my absolute limit and I can't do any more. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think where it becomes more difficult though, is when you start to look at where, like the mental aspects of it, right, Amber? Cause mm-hmm. this is the interesting thing. It's where are my limits, and like, right. and how do I manage that? And because that's something that, yes, it is learned over time, but for new riders, what sort of tips can we give new riders that are looking at this and trying to find their limits, mentally speaking?
Well, I was just going to, quick one for me, is I'm a broken record on this one, but approach it with curiosity and enthusiasm. Like, mm-hmm. let's see what I can do. But Chad, you jump in.
Find that limit.
Yeah, he found it. So,
oh, you're in my rib laughing.
So, Cecilia, I want to draw attention to one term you used. You ask, how can I push my limits in a sustainable way? And I do like that you use that term, because it implies that you're looking at the bigger picture, not something you can do one workout and then dread every subsequent workout, but something you can do each time. It does need to be sustainable, because just like fitness, this is a process. You're not going to be instantly good at it. You're not going to be instantly tough, not as tough as you can get anyway. So over time, you get a little fitter, you get a little tougher, you get a little more accepting of what this level of discomfort is, that it's not a threat to your system, that it's a necessary component of training, and it will make you faster. All these things come with time.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that a lot of it too is, if you commit to training and you commit to failure, that's a portion of it. Like, you commit to finding those sort of limits, and that's kind of how it goes. Like, it comes down to the mindset that you have. Like, if you have like this fixed mindset versus a growth mindset, and growth implies the fact that you have to find and kind of bump up against like those failure points. And there's a difference between living with fear of failure and then also learning from failure, right, Nate? And kind of like learning how to live with that.
And so I am classic. I like to find the limits early and then back off a little bit, because I hate the idea of operating through life at 60% of your potential when you could really do a lot more and you never figure it out. And the other thing to think about is your limits are always expanding. And the closer you operate at your limits, is now another option to be able to test them again and again and again. It's not a one-time thing. And just in general in your life, if you can do things that make you uncomfortable, because that's really what it's talking about. So anything, you don't like speaking to someone, speak to a lot of people, right? And then suddenly that's not a limit anymore. And now maybe it's speaking in front of 100 people, and then it's 1,000, right? So the more you can push yourself, the better it is. And that's the same with sport, business, relationships, all of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there's nothing wrong. I mean, so you push yourself a little too hard in one workout, you blow up. So what? It's money in the bank. You just learned something super valuable, and it doesn't mean you can't come back the next day and really nail the next workout. So there, you know, be curious and don't worry. Don't be afraid to like bump up against those limits.
Yeah. Sometimes it takes 8 weeks, but not always just one workout, Amber. But it's good to find those limits so you can beat people at Cape Epic.
Right. And, okay. There you go. No, but to Nate's point, like, and what we're saying is, you know, don't be afraid to push yourself, but also you don't have to be pushing yourself to failure. You don't have to be blowing yourself up every single day. There's usually 2 workouts per week that are really key workouts that are really, really, those are the hard ones. And usually if you're doing a training road plan and you look at your week ahead, you know exactly which ones those are. Mm-hmm. So don't, you know, with those ones, settle into your mind that this is going to, you know, that you might have to literally take the entire workout 5 seconds at a time, and that's okay. Mm-hmm. You can do that. It's totally possible. I've done it myself. And then the other thing is, again, going back, like each of those energy systems that you're stressing is going to, the sensation is going to be different. The type of challenge is going to be different. So the sensations that you'll get from the challenge of a sweet spot workout are going to be really different from the sensations that are going to challenge you from a VO2 max workout. And, you know, that is also something that you learn as you progress through a training plan. You start to get familiar with that, like, okay, I got VO2 today. I know exactly how that's going to feel. It's not going to be pretty. But I know that if I break it down 10 seconds, 5 seconds at a time, if I count, if I have a mantra, if I have a really good piece of music, I know I can get through those workouts if I take them one interval at a time. So I would just submit that to you. Don't be afraid to get outside of your comfort zone and really bump up against those limits, but know that you don't have to do that every single day with every single workout.
Yeah, to Nate's point about the fact that if you continue to find those limits and live close to those limits and push those limits, you get better at finding new limits. And I think that this is something that I've gotten much better at in the training process over the years. But I fall out of it. If I take time off training, geez, even like 2 days off, if I take 2 days off, I come back and I'm like, oh, this hurts. Like everything is uncomfortable, you know? And it all kind of operates on different levels or different scale, but it's all part of the training process. Like part of it is, you know, we're struggling, we're trying to achieve something, and implied in struggle is a high risk of failure. Like that's going to happen. And it's okay. It's okay to do it.
If you're not pretty often failing in life, you're not living life to what it could be for yourself.
Yeah.
So it's failures. It's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. You need to fail often. We need to teach our kids to fail, like that being okay. And everybody, employees, bosses, sport, going, we talk about a lot of times, going for that move that's probably not going to work, but maybe I'm going to learn something. Chad said at the beginning, the Vikings, where they either win or they learn. Same, it's the same concept.
Yeah.
I just did a webinar the other day. We were talking about a similar topic, and one of the gals there just had a baby. We were talking about toddlers, and I pointed out that, you know, you watch a little kid learning to walk, and they topple over. They're not going to lay on the ground and go, "Oh, stupid, you know, guys suck. Yeah. Never going to learn how to walk. That other baby has probably learned how to walk 5 days ago. Man, you know, I mean, it's silly. It's a learning process, and yeah, we're going to stumble and we're going to fall. But I mean, our you know. It's not something to beat yourself up over, like, because you just learned something really important.
If you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
Do it.
If you think I have better hair than Jonathan, give it a thumbs up. If not, leave a comment.
My hair is better than his.